Good afternoon, friends. So, looks like many of your friends have already gone into the holy mode. But I'm so glad that you guys have turned up. Now, we are going to go to the next unit, which deals with two things. One, first and foremost, it goes into the principles of construction. And beyond that, we have the masonry work. Okay. Masonry work is the most commonly used work which you will see, be it in a prefabricated construction, computer lab, it's not there. Okay, I guess I must have forgotten it in the room. Anyway, it's no problem. Coming back here, masonry is the most commonly used element which you can see. Can you think of, what is masonry first and foremost? But, let me just go back to, as usual, to the old topics which we do. In the last four classes, we were looking at what prefabrication was, the merits, demerits, what are the considerations that you take into account when you are going to do a design, and also most importantly, we find that there is a relative shortcoming in terms of cost and the ability to transport elements. The larger the element, more difficult it is, more consideration for safety is to be given. However, the biggest strength is the speed. This was seen in the in all the high-rise buildings. Okay, the twin towers, the even in the hotel which we saw, 15 stories. In 15 days they did 30 stories. Okay, all these are remarkable things which are only possible if you are going to use prefabrication. In one of the interactions it was asked, what about the foundation? Foundation can also be prefabricated, okay, for steel structures. If you are looking at an industrial shed, the industrial shed will sit on a short pedestal. It's called as a pedestal, and there is a pad at the bottom. The pad spreads the load and a pedestal sits on the pad. And whatever is the connection arrangement required, okay, maybe bolting, I'm just requesting you to ensure that your mobile phone is to yourself. You can go to the last row if something very important is there, okay? So, as usual, I don't know, you may be all scientists like Einstein, you know, we don't know when the apple is going to fall on somebody's head. We don't know what is that super message that's going to click, okay? So, I don't mind it, but please don't involve your neighbor in that, okay? So, fine. Coming back here, so the prefabricated units are having their own. Yeah, so you can actually prefabricate even the foundation elements. Foundation elements can be prefabricated. However, excavation is something you have to do in site. Okay. Now, coming to a typical construction phase. Okay, typical construction phase. If you are going to be asked what is the principle of construction, these are some of the outlining facts that are there. Your construction doesn't start at a site. Construction never starts at the site. Construction starts when one man or one person or one group decides that they want some work to be done. Please wait for some time. So, at that point, only construction actually starts. Construction starts when one person has an idea to start something. Only after that, they have a lot of other things in between. Okay. Now, have you heard the term civil contractor? How many of you are going to become contractors? How many of you are going to work under a contractor? Or how many of you are going to work under a contracting firm? L&T is a contracting firm. Okay, so IPM where I work, it is a contracting firm. Okay, CCCL where I work, it was a contracting firm. So all of us were contractors with a little more respectability. That's what my boss used to say. He used to say that you are all just different, okay? You just wear a nice shirt and pant, probably wear a tie. That is the only difference. End of the day, you are still a contractor. Now, who is a contractor? What's a contractor? Contract is a legal document between two parties. One party states, I want the work done. Another party states, I will do it for you. They both enter into a contract, something like a marriage. You do this, I do this for you. So now all this happens almost at the conceptual stage, okay, or before the contractor actually comes in. Of course, the contractor does some pre-tender work. He needs to understand what kind of work is going to be there before he gives the cost. He cannot give a cost and back out also, because it's a legal document he has entered with the other party. Okay, then there is a design phase. Maybe the person will design and ask the contractor to build, or the contractor himself will design and do. Pre-construction phase, people think, what are the equipment that you require in that particular place? Is it a very wet place? Will it require dewatering? Okay, it's a very important thing to consider when you make deep excavations. So things like this go in the pre-construction phase, where a lot of planning is done. And finally, you come to the construction phase, where you actually get to the brass tacks, where you come, you see what is to be done and actually get it done. Then the most important phase is the post-construction phase, or the handing over phase, where you hand over the work to the party. That party looks at all the things, whether it's performing the way he wants, whether whatever he wants has gone into it and stuff like it, okay. He will be looking at some of the legal documents. Will be your drawings, it will be your specifications, and it will be some method statements sometimes, so on and so forth, okay. So when all these things are complied with, then they say that the work is done, okay. So now I'm going to go a little into the construction components part. According to syllabus, it's only masonry, and most of the other things are what you frankly should be able to see. Even this is something which you have seen. However, we are going to go into this a little detail, okay. Basically, before I go into masonry, these are some of the points I'd like to touch. These are the materials which you will use. This is a very broad outline. Okay, so metals and alloys. Okay, when I say metal, can you think of some metal which is used in construction? Steel? Aluminium? Aluminium is a very important construction material. It's an emerging construction material. All your window frames currently in India are made of aluminium. See, brass, copper, okay, sometimes nickel, chromium. Where is chromium used? Where is chromium used? Chromium is used in your taps. Okay, chromium taps. Okay, stainless steel. Stainless steel is used as a reinforcement in places where corrosion is expected. Very costly. It's a very costly material to use as a reinforcement, but people use it. Then cement and its derivatives. Any doubt about that? I don't think there's any doubt about that. What are these bituminous materials? Things made of tar. So these are road, for road material, for your ceiling materials, for your jointing materials, tar is used. So polymers, we talked a lot about polymers and fiber composites. Now I'm coming to masonry. Masonry is nothing but arrangement of blocks. Okay, how many of you have played with this when you were small? Many of us would have played. Okay, so even I used to play, and even my children play with these blocks. Okay, so a lot can be done with those blocks. Okay, so what is masonry? Masonry is built with individual elements. These individual elements can be bricks, hollow blocks, okay, or you may go for other units, including stone. For instance, we were talking about masonry around VAT. It's made of stone, okay. Then you got also this hollow blocks and cellular concrete. So usually they are all done in horizontal courses. Each course is a layer. They are all done in layers, and they are cemented together with some kind of mortar. They are cemented together with some kind of mortar. So these are the elements. You got some blocks, you got some mortar, you do some pointing work, or you do some finishing work. What is this pointing? What is this finishing? We'll go step by step. So this is a mortar. It's a homogeneous mix of some cementitious material with water. See, if not water, some other agent which makes the, which initiates the chemical reactions. And you also add some inert materials. Okay, the inert materials usually help in reducing the effects of heat of hydration. So using only plain cement, it's going to cause enormous heat of hydration. So you just use some inert materials which help in reducing that effect. Then you go for a good consistency, and also you look at workability. What is this consistency? Consistency is the, yes, yeah, tell me here. How it feels like, okay, how the material feels like. For instance, if you are going to do wall plastering, the consistency cannot, will have to be different than when you are doing the ceiling plastering. Do you think doing the ceiling plastering is the same as doing the wall plastering? Have you seen people plaster the ceiling? So definitely not. Okay, in fact, so what is workability? The ability to be to mix the mortar or, you know, apply it is workability. The amount of energy which you essentially require to get it into the particular shape is workability. So how do you select a mortar? You need to know what is the material you are using for jointing. Okay, then you have to know the strength of individual masonry unit. If you know the strength of individual masonry unit, you know how high the masonry unit is going to go. If you are having a very strong material and the material can go to great height, but if your mortar is weak, what will happen? The mortar will start to crumble and crush. The mortar will start to crumble and crash, thereby defeating the entire purpose of using the masonry itself. Then another very important thing is exposure. Okay, where you are going to do your exposure? If you see the structures which are near the beach, you will find that many times the paint has come out. Many times the reinforcement rod of the ceiling is exposed. Many times there is falling. Okay, the concrete is just breaking off from the surface. Okay, and this is because of the saline atmosphere it is exposed to. Same way, the mortar gets exposed to different kinds of conditions. Okay, now, do you think the exposure condition of the mortar on the inside of this wall and outside is the same? No. What is the difference? That more exposure to what? Sun, maybe pollution, water, all the person said, yeah? So all these things are there with are coming into contact with the mortar which is outside than when it, what it is on the inside. So in fact, you'll find that the specification for external plastering will call for thicker coats of plaster. That is, there will be multiple layers than what it's on the inside. Okay. Then again, another thing is, what is it contact with? For example, have you seen a septic tank under construction? Okay, septic tank, okay, what is the nature of material which goes into a septic tank? Acidic, basic, neutral, chemical properties. It is acidic, okay, lot of acids are formed. So that is one kind of exposure. Now what about the water? What about the water tank? Okay, have you seen a water tank which is being built? Usually you plaster the outside face and the inside face, because you don't want roots or even water to move into the brickwork. So you keep, you plaster both the external surface as well as the internal surface. So what happens is, now there are two kinds of exposure. One side, there's constant alteration between wetting and drying. Other side is exposed to soil. It is in touch with soil. So what is there in soil? A lot of salts. We know that from our basic biology, because can one of you please come this side? Yeah, the three, the group of three. Yes, thank you. Let that gap remain. Okay, I'm just making it a little hard for you to distract another person. Right, you can just sit there. Thank you. So what happens is, all these salts can contain quite a spectrum of materials. It can be chlorates, it can be sulfates, sulfites, nitrates, we don't know. So all these can be detrimental to the mortar itself. So how you decide what goes in the mortar is based on what is the work it is going to do also. Okay, so if you don't follow this, you are going to find that your thing is not going to be very effective. Okay, now please use IS 2250. Okay, please use IS 2250, because this gives details about mortar. What I have done is I have taken the fundamental portion of mortar, the terms which I feel you couldn't have understood, like exposure and all these things probably you don't know. For that reason I have gone through the fundamentals. The rest of the stuff is very straightforward. Okay, because I went through the code, I found it very straightforward. Now we are going to the next part of the brickwork. Okay, we are going to now arrange the units in some pattern. Why is it important that we have to arrange the blocks in a pattern? Why not we do it as we like? The reason is, if you do it as you like, there's a chance that you will have vertical joints. What is this vertical joint? If you look at the brickwork, you see that there is some array like lines, vertical and horizontal lines. If the vertical lines come in the same row, that means all the load is getting transferred and it's a plane of weakness. So what we do is we arrange the bricks in such a manner that vertical joints are avoided. And even if suppose like in a corner you feel that there's a vertical joint coming, you arrange it in such a manner that it keys in position. It keys into position. Okay. So yeah, basically this one shouldn't have come here. However, since it is there, I am just putting it. See, this metal ties are being used in a cavity wall. What is a cavity wall? There is basically a gap between two layers of the wall. It is used for insulating purposes. Very cold countries, air acts as a good insulator. Okay, for the woolen sweater is also a good insulator because of air. Because of air, not because of gap, because of the air. Air is what is making the, is the thing which gives the insulation property. Okay. Now this is a brick wall. This is a typical brick wall which is done in houses. I am sure you would have seen this. See, in the olden days, they used only bricks. No concrete was there. Here, this is a cold chute. All these are from Google images only. Okay. So this is a cold chute where they, and also they have the brick foundation. Okay, brick steps, brick foundation, everything is brick. And this is a brick arch. It is a brick arch, and arch is a structure which is actually in compression throughout. When you come to the next strength of materials course, you'll be told that arch has compression at all the points. Okay, so it can just rest because of its self weight itself. One of the first jobs I was doing was with a railway contractor. So now there we had these stone arches for the railway bridges. It was so tough that the excavator was only breaking hydraulic lines and the claw which was there on that arm. So it was so tough to break these arches. This is a compound wall. This is another arch. This is a curved pattern in the wall. Okay, so this is something about bricks. Brick is one of the oldest building material. Okay, and it's cheap, very durable. In fact, brick is very fire resistant. Unlike other materials, brick is fire resistant. Brick is a lining for many of the chimneys. Many of the steel chimneys or other chimneys have brick as a insulating layer inside. So, and also it's very easy to handle. What is the size of a brick? It's quite small. And have you seen some women will be carrying about 10 or 12 bricks on their head. when in a construction site. Okay, so this is why we say it's easy to handle, and it can be used in the interior or exterior wall. Beauty of brick is, even if suppose if you get very good quality brick, you can leave it exposed and it still gives a very good appearance. Brick still gives a very good appearance. Okay, so these are some of the uses of bricks. Now, what are the qualities of a good brick? We were having a mason's training workshop. They were all familiar with the qualities of a good brick. Okay, brick, if you drop it from about 1 meter, according to our code, it should not fall, it should not break. Then, have you noticed masons, whenever they take the brick, they just toss it in the air, catch it, yes, and then they slightly tap it with the trowel. When they tap it, you should hear a ringing sound. And when you hit two bricks also, it should give a ringing sound. Bricks should look uniform. If they don't look uniform, it means they have not been baked properly. If you soak brick, it should, depending on the quality, first quality, second quality, third quality, it should not absorb more than 20-22% and 24% by its weight of water. And when you take it out of water, it should not crumble. If it crumbles, it means that it's not been baked properly. Then the test for brick, whether it's hard enough, is by scratching it with your fingernail. It should not get scratched when you rub it, when you scratch it with your fingernail. Okay, so these are some of the things which you normally look for in a brick, which you're using for masonry work. Again, you cannot build an infinite height of a wall with masonry, because masonry has finite compression strength. Usually that's why they prefer that. Nowadays brick quality has become so bad that every meter or so they prefer to keep a concrete band. If not a concrete band, every alternate layer they'll keep a mesh. The reason is to prevent uneven settlement. When you have uneven settlement, you'll start to get cracks in the wall. Okay, you'll find cracks in the wall. Sometimes, now you see there is a gap which is filled between this beam and this wall. Do you know why? This beam tends to sag. This beam, concrete beam, tends to sag. You cannot see it with your naked eye. However, when the brick wall is touching the beam, it will start to crack, because the load from the beam is starting to be transferred to the brick wall. It will take the load for some time, but when it cannot take, there will be a crack which appears. Once a crack appears, no load can go across, basically. Okay. Now, these are the parts of a brick. You call this the stretcher face. You call the narrower part, then this face, the header face. This course at the bottom is called the bed course. On top of the brick, you will not have such a huge indentation. Usually the name of the brick manufacturer, ABC, XYZ, is all marked there. That is called the frog. Okay, that frog acts as a area where you can put in mortar, and it prevents sliding between blocks. It acts as a mechanism for keying in place. Okay, so this is called the aris or the edge, and F is the margin which you got around the brick. Okay, now these are the cuts of brick. If you are going to arrange bricks, you have to cut the bricks. So these are the methods, or these are the ways you cut the brick. Okay, so you got a king closure, which is beveled, a queen closure, a snapped header, a beveled closure where it's splayed at an angle. These are called bats. Brick bats are small pieces of brick which is used for filling in gaps. Okay, so this is called as a quarter bat, three quarter bat, half brick is a snapped header, then you got a beveled brick, and you got a beveled bat. Okay, so these are the various types of cuts which you do to a brick. Now, you are going to lay the bricks in an arrangement. Okay, such an arrangement is masonry. The way you arrange it, you can arrange the bricks in quite a lot of ways. Okay, so These are some of the ways you can lay an individual brick. Okay, the stretcher. Okay, stretcher is where you lay horizontally lengthwise. Okay, header is the other way round. And the sailor and soldier are two other. These formats are normally not used. Okay, see, you are keeping the brick flat header, keeping the brick like this to the face stretcher. If you are keeping like this, it's called a shiner. Normally you don't see the brick placed like this. Then you got a roll up, soldier and sailor. So these are some of the ways you do, but this soldier and sailor I have not seen in practice. When you arrange alternate header and stretcher, you call it as a English bond. You call it as an English bond. This is a 1.5 brick wall. Okay. Usually this will be 350 mm wide, but if you are going to use only one brick, you'll have only this layer. Okay, so on this stretcher below you'll have header placed. You'll have a header placed. This is a 1.5 brick wall, and you'll find it. You'll usually use this when you are going to go for transformer walls and stuff like that. Okay. So this is the this is again 1.5 thick English bond. Again, now look at this. This is the Flemish bond. Look at the way the bricks are arranged. Header immediately below stretcher. Again header. Now the thing is, in none of these cases, you will find that you have the vertical joints in one straight line. Okay, this is the aim of keeping a bond. This is the aim of keeping arranging the bricks in a bond. The next type of brick is wall is the garden wall bond. Okay, look, this is the garden wall bond. Can you see you got a queen closure kept here? This is kept so that we can get the arrangement, the bond in place. Okay, so usually when you go for the English bond, you'll find that there are three courses of header to every one course of, you'll have every three courses of stretchers for every course of header. And in the Fleming bond, this is called as the Flemish bond. Okay, just like what we saw earlier, you'll find that there's one header to every three stretchers. You'll find that there's one header for every three stretchers. This is called as a rat trap bond. You'll find that you can keep pockets where you can fill it with concrete and also keep some reinforcement. This will become a reinforced wall, so it has better performance when it is subjected to earthquake. Okay, and this is again, these are hollow blocks. The you can insert steel rods, okay, vertical reinforcements, as well as you can keep some horizontal reinforcements, and you'll be able to grout, or you know, just grout means you pour some cement mortar paste into the gap. It will harden and it will act like mini columns within the brick wall. Okay, then you got this herringbone pattern. Okay, can you see, this is a decorative pattern. Okay, you can arrange walls also like that. So as an example, can you see the various patterns which are there? In fact, for the exam, I propose to keep a question, identify the bond. Take some pictures from Google, ask you to identify what kind of bond is there. Okay, so you can again see, you got a kind of bond here, then you got a herringbone pattern here. And yes, again, we've got quite a few. See here, arch is there. You got a bond here, then you got another bond in this place. Okay, so this is a brief introduction to brick and brick masonry. Okay, this is a very brief introduction to brick and brick masonry. For brick masonry and for the mortar which is used, you have standard practices. Okay, for instance, you need to wet the bricks before you place it. Okay, so many of these things are well known to all the people. We want you to just, we'll encourage you to go and look into the codes and understand what we are expected to do as engineers.